This is a rare video in and of itself because this is the first time we've had two 7-inch devices compared against each other. Currently, up until this point, the Amazon Oasis 2 and 3 are the only e-reader to occupy the 7-inch screen size. Everyone else is 6.8, 7.8, etc. Anyways, let's dive into it. Here's the home screen on both of these. We'll start on the Kobo. You get books, collections, Kobo store, wishlist, settings, help, etc. And here you can click on the settings, the drop-down menu as well. You have settings, view special offers, Goodreads, Amazon free time. There's a whole bunch of stuff here. You'll have to look at the individual review videos if you want to see them in a deeper level. This is more of a comparison. You do have your books displayed in center here, as well as your library. You have my books down below. You can't really scroll or go anywhere else on here on the Kobo. However, you do have a scroller bar, which was introduced in recent times for the Amazon devices. You can scroll that down, new releases in the Kindle store, Goodreads friends recommended for you. The second page is basically just everything to do with selling you on stuff, down to the ads when we registered this in Japan, and we're in Vancouver right now and we're still getting the Japanese ads, all the way to the store, Goodreads. It's basically just selling you on stuff. Most of it actually is, if you think about it, from the just about that much is yours, the rest is theirs. So let's dive into a book and see how that looks. We have the same font style, margin, and line spacing on both of these. Different book, but that's okay. We're just gonna look at what they both can do. You can turn pages by swiping, tapping, or pressing the physical page turn button. Pressing and holding the physical page turn button on the Kobo buzzes through the book. Pressing the physical page turn button on the Kindle does not. Tapping in the center on the Kobo and the top of the Kindle, tapping in the center of the Kindle does nothing. You do have some ways to change your experience. We'll go to the page display and the font settings. You do have some font styles, bold, size. Same with here, you have font size, line spacing, margins. You have some page options, margin, spacing, orientation, alignment, reading, and some themes which you can actually save. So if you max out all the margins and line spacing, you can save that to large, and you can name it your own, etc. So that's some decent ways to change stuff on the Kindle. Everything changes live. Same with the Kobo. However, we do have an advanced menu, which is always really cool. It bears mentioning that you can actually choose a before and after of what you want it to look like, and it changes the entire book into your specified reading environment that you want for yourself. So there's a lot of ways to change your experience on both of these. You do have long press on both of these as well. Kindle is a little bit slower. You have highlight. We're going to check on note, however, because this is going to show off the keyboard. The keyboard on the Kobo has always been kind of unconventional because everything's stacked in lines, whereas this is more conventional because it's staggered. True QWERTY keyboard, kind of not so true QWERTY keyboard. You'll see that the keys on the Amazon are larger, but they miss the row of numbers. You'll have to go into the secondary and tertiary options to get all those special symbols respectively. Now, you do have something really cool on the Kindle that not really anyone else even touches. You'll see here we have highlight, add note, and search on Facebook, Wikipedia, InBook, and Google. However, on the Kindle, you get translation. That is really nice because you can change any book, any PDF, any document from any language to any language you see on this drop-down menu, even simplified and traditional Chinese. So it really breaks down the barriers for people that want to read books that are not in their language. You also have bookmarks up top, although I think the Kobo bookmark looks a lot cooler. And tapping at the top again, you have some other stuff like reading settings, disable touchscreen if you just want to use the physical buttons. And Kobo doesn't really have that, but they have some statistics down below of how much you've read in the book, etc. There's also some new features on the Kobo that haven't been on previous units of Kobo Rakuten devices, like the extra additional information top and bottom and the little black progress bar at the bottom that they've added, especially for the Libra. By default, the Amazon kind of fits it in the middle, whereas they stretch it to pretty much the height, or if not just at least the bottom on the Kobo. But again, we're just splitting hairs here, kind of nitpicking on everything. If you long press, they both don't do anything for the physical page turn buttons. You actually have to press them individually. They don't buzz through the book like they would on an actual novel with text. The Kindle can and will long press on text, which is very cool. So you can long press on something, box a big range of text, and you still get all those options like translation, and you just see it in about 2 seconds, it translated it all into Japanese, which is really cool. You can't do any long pressing on the Kobo, but you can do pinch and zoom, and it gives you a little mini map. On the Kindle, if you pinch and zoom, it gives you a mini map as well on the top right corner, and you can choose where you want to land it, let go, and then it renders. On the Kobo, sometimes it hangs, sometimes you have to kind of go back to it, and you can see it spazzes out a little bit. So the Kobo Libra wouldn't really be the ideal device for reading PDFs, whereas Amazon has actually had a lot of time and a lot of generations to figure it out and really optimize the experience since the Kindle Paperwhite 2. Amazon has always had a very good manga experience, as mostly because they've catered it towards manga readers, especially in Japan. They have released the manga model, which is the Kindle Paperwhite 3. It had 32 gigabytes on board, as well as the Kobo having 32 gigabyte variant in certain markets, not all markets. This is the manga experience on both of these, and this is what I was talking about on the Kindle. You get this quick navigation bar, and it's really cool because if you just drag a little bit, you can go at a slower pace all the way through the book, or if you just drag it all the way to the right, you get 100% speed in either direction, which is really, really nice because you still see what's going on, and this thing is lightning quick, back and forth. You can go all day, it never hangs, it never stalls, and it renders immediately. The Kobo is very good at reading manga as well. You can press and hold the physical page turn buttons and it will zip through the book at an all right speed, I suppose. However, the Kindle is a little bit quicker and a little bit better, I'd say. Yes, we're reading a sample because we're not downloading content on these as they are review samples, but you will see that they are the exact same manga. Wow, you get a lot of pages on the Amazon sample. You get about 8 more pages in the Kobo. That's another plus, I guess we should mention, that the preview on the Kindle for manga seems to be a lot longer than the Kobo ones. Can you pinch and zoom on both of these? You do have the ability to pinch and zoom. However, they both kind of display a good amount of manga as it is, so I wouldn't say pinch and zooming is actually that necessary because they're both quite readable, and in Japan this is around the size of a manga because they're scaled down there versus the American English translated counterparts that are sold here in Canada and America. So they both have their own little spin on how to get through the pages really quick and display the text and the imagery very nicely. What you guys are seeing is correct. This is the same shot. It's not split. The Kindle Oasis on the right has more oranges in it, and the Kobo Libra seems to have more green. And you can correct this by using the natural light and making it kind of orange candlelighty, or you can find a nice white balance in the center. This is the first time ever an Amazon device has it as well. You can compare the orange lights. Looks like the Kobo on the left is a slightly bit more pale, but you can actually change them both to whatever kind of setting you want. I must note something that bothers me personally is that on the Kobo, it doesn't actually change anything till you let go, but that's a small price to pay for the quality. However, on the Kindle, it is a true slider and it is a dang good one as well. You will see that the color is immediate. It is very, very quick. It's responsive, and the white balance is very nice as well. In terms of light distribution, I mean, they're both fantastic. There's no overexposed places, dark places. The Oasis 3 is flush screen and bezel, and the Libra is a little bit recessed, so it does go down like that, but they're both fantastic. Amazon and Kobo have been battling out for many moons. They have borrowed each other's design cues at certain times. They competed to get, you know, waterproof devices, warm lighting, flush screen and bezels, better store experience, special offers, no special offers, the list goes on. They have both been in the race for as long as we can remember, but it doesn't really matter which one you go with. They're both extremely good devices. Amazon is a super, super, really high-end seller. Kobo is available in tons of countries and has overdrive compatibility. They're both solid devices, and between this particular matchup in the Oasis 3 and the Libra is a steal because it's actually $80 USD less than the Oasis 3. Now, these numbers can go up or down in either direction based on where you buy it, the size of the hard drive, 8 gig, 32 gig, or if you want wireless or cellular connectivity on the Amazon. For a comparison between the Oasis 3 and the Kobo Libra, both 2019 devices, this is Peter.